Hello and welcome to the vlog. The wilderness trail boats featured in the last episode are not the only fibreglass craft to be found on the British canals and rivers. The closer you get to a river, the more likely you are to see a vast array of different GRP cruisers. Often derogatively referred to as yogurt pots, these boats are often more affordable than a narrowboat, arguably more suited to river conditions, and are a more conventional way of getting on the water, especially for messing about in a boat over the summer months. So I went to a marina in the Midlands to meet a man who's bought such a boat of a type specifically designed for both narrow canals and river cruising.
I love water, I love being by water, I love the solitude of it all. I like my own space. And a situation occurred where I needed to do something different and talked about it with my partner and said, right, I'm going to go out and buy a boat. And I thought she was going to say, you're completely nuts, which is the normal response that I get from anything I want to do. We said, no, I think that's a really good idea. And that means that you can go and spend a lot of nights on the boat and I can have some peace and quiet. I didn't certainly have the urge to wear a captain's hat and some kind of t-shirt with a rope and anchor on or anything like that, but certainly something along the lines of being able to sit there on the deck with the top down, gin and tonic. The whole idea of having something that could be fun and was definitely a recreational thing rather than more like a little bit of a home from home. I understand why people would even try and liveaboard these things, because they are like that. I mean, other than the fact that in the winter they're not warm, same thing with any GRP boat, they're subject to condensation, they're not insulated, so you would really feel the cold. But I when I'm moored up in the marina, a lovely marina here, I just hook up the shore power, turn the heater on, sit and watch videos or DVDs or whatever and have a great time. It is peace and tranquility.
The thing you notice about this cabin, actually two things. First of all, just how much light there is coming in from these wonderful windows. You can straight away just see out, see everything. You're not feeling like you're trapped inside a cramped space at all. And the second thing is that it's just so cozy. It's like being in my camper van, but you're on a boat. I'm surprised by how great it feels. I wasn't expecting to just feel this cozy at all. Do you know, I want one of these. So strong was my adoration of the boat that I subsequently went to see one for sale. 30 years old and at what seemed to be a very low price. I thought it could make an interesting project boat for fun and larks over winter. A 10 horsepower petrol outboard at the back, as they tend to have. Tiny solar panel on the roof to keep the leisure battery topped up. And, being the same model as Martin's, the cockpit's in the middle, with a canvas cover over it to keep the rain out. Ahead of the steering position is the door to the front living area. Behind is a door to a rear cabin. One thing you definitely notice is how much bouncier these boats are than steel ones. I was just shifting my weight here, and look how it rocks. I'll show you the back cabin, set out with a single bed that pulls out to a double, and there's a little sink to the side. The outboard motor can be accessed under that wooden cabinet at the back. But beware on old boats, something's been letting water in, and this wood was rotten. Probably not too hard to replace, mind you. The front cabin combines a dinette on the left, which also makes up to a bed, with an additional V-berth at the front, under which is the water tank. Again, no surprises in a 30-year-old boat to find some water ingress ruining this wooden shelf. The galley boasts a sink and gas hob with two burners, underneath which is a grill for doing toast and a little oven below that. This is all fairly standard on the Viking 26 cruisers, as far as I can tell. The gas-fired water heater looked very new, I must say. And it also supplies hot water to the shower room behind, which contains a portable toilet too. Just as on Martin's boat, the cabin is light and airy, and you get an excellent view out, in this case just of a marina. But if you're looking for one of these, what can you get for your money? I had a search on boats.com at a variety of prices.
Take this 1995 Viking 23, for example. On at $9,500, that seems to be fairly typical pricing for the age. A very similar layout and look to the Viking 26, but without the rear cabin. It looked quite smart from the pictures, and there's lots of info in the sales description. What about a Viking 26, though, like the ones I've shown in this video? Here's one from 1988 at $14,000, which again seems to be about the ballpark, depending on condition. It's hard to tell from photographs, of course. You'd want to go and have a really good look around yourself and get a hull survey done, which might have to be done for insurance purposes anyway. The companies tend to require that when boats reach a certain age. With fibreglass boats, the main hull problem is osmosis of the fibreglass, where water gets into it, but it can be treated. Notice how the beam is stated as 6 feet 10 inches, exactly the same as a narrowboat, meaning this can fit all the narrow canals and canal locks. How about something a bit bigger? Viking make boats of various sizes, and here at $20,000 is a 28-foot model, this one dating from 1992, but according to the listing, having had lots of more modern upgrades and improvements. And what if you're feeling a bit flash and have money burning a hole in your pocket? Then a more modern Viking 32cc Highline might take your fancy at £36,000. Built in 2013, this is clearly more modern, less tired and more stylish. Notice the much more up-to-date hob and sink unit, as well as the fridge and oven. Plus the woodwork is clearly still very shiny. And it's still narrow enough to do all the canals. By the way, this video is not an advert or sponsored by Boats.com. They just had a good selection, which I thought useful to give you an idea of what costs what. I'll leave a link in the video description. Buying an older boat can be a money pit, of course. You must have your wits about you. For Martin, the electrics were, shall we say, interesting.
Lights were flickering, very little things, silly things. Certain gauges weren't working properly, and I thought, this is just a wiring situation. So pulled out where the steering position is, took the helm wheel off, unscrewed the bits there and looked underneath and thought, oh my God, you know, spaghetti wouldn't even come close to it. And you had different colours of the same wire patched together with connectors and God knows what. So what might be in a neutral colour in blue was then going to terminate in brown. You're thinking, oh my God, how do I do this? So I thought the only thing to do is to literally rip it out and start again.
And with most cruiser engines being petrol-driven outboards, there are other aspects you need to consider too.
Some fuel stations, they have particularly strict rules about what you, how much you can fill up into cans, you know. But then again, if you take your car in and you're filling your car up and you're then filling your can at the same time, they don't really say anything to you because a sail is a sail, it's the way it is. I don't keep petrol cans on the boat as such, but I'm very lucky. This is a cruiser with a 70 litre inbuilt stainless steel fuel tank. And 70 litres of petrol is going to take you a very long way. It's a lot of cruising hours, so I don't worry about it. And if necessary, you know, I've got a 5 litre little can in the back of the car if I need it, and I can always whiz out and get one. The longest cruise I've done is probably a week solid cruising, and I still had more than a third left in my fuel tank from filling it up. And that's doing an awful lot. I mean, that was constant cruising. That wasn't stopping much. It was to move a boat from one place to another.
Cruisers may not be for everyone. They're not the traditional historic steel canal boat, but Martin says they can make the perfect getaway.
It's a gingerbread house on the water, really. So it's a bit of a dream place. It's more of a fantasy place than a reality. Somewhere you can shut yourself away and just, you know, even now, just listening to the rain falling, it's an awful day, but it's not. It's a happy day because, you know, being afloat, it just makes you feel different. And it's this, how are the words that have been used in the past? Splendid isolation.
If you're wondering, I didn't buy that cruiser. With insurance, license, survey and all the extra fees on top, it all got way too expensive. But maybe one day. Cheerio.